our people in Canada. He walks uphill both ways to work in 2 feet of snow. He holds the record for the longest drive in North America. I heard about that, it was over a frozen lake, right? He invented the internet in Canada. Ladies and gentlemen, Dean Shareski.
Yeah, I've never had an introduction like that, or had to follow after the activity that Carl had for you this morning, which was really good. That's actually a pretty powerful way to start a day where you kind of get everybody's juices flowing and feel like they have some enemies and vested interests in the day and sort of get together with some controversial ideas. And that's actually really powerful. I think it's such an important thing for us to get together here, for you guys to be able to do this and connect and just kind of challenge each other and learn from each other, which is kind of what I want to speak with you today. Just a little bit more background, because most of the things that Carl said were completely false. So just to sort of give you a bit of a context for who I am, and then we'll get started here. I'm a lot of different things online as well as offline. Family person, I'm a teacher. I teach at the University of Regina. I teach pre-service teachers. I've been doing that for about the last 6 years. I worked at a school district. I was a classroom teacher for 14 years in elementary, and then was at the district level. Similar positions to many that you are in for 10 years, working in the instructional technology side of things. And then beginning in January, actually, I'm on a new adventure. I'm working now for Discovery Education as the community builder for Canada. And that's kind of a big role. That's a big space. So I've been doing a lot of traveling in the last 3 months. What do I need to do, Tim?
You're fine.
I'm hearing some echo on my side that's going to kind of bug me, but
I have no control over that at all.
All right.
I'm just recording you.
Okay. I'm getting a little bit of feedback here that's just sort of coming in my ear. You guys hearing me too?
Yes.
It's Carl's fault.
All right.
Everybody turn off your phone.
So that's been a new venture for me. Really exciting to be able to sort of see things from a different perspective. When you get to travel around, I was having a conversation with someone I met this morning about what I'm noticing. And Texas really is, in so many ways, the epitome of the things I'm seeing in terms of particularly the challenges of really big districts as compared to smaller districts, and the affordances and differences that you can do in terms of innovation and progress. It's challenging. When you're in a big district, it is really the layers of bureaucracy and you know, challenges you have moving forward. It's tough. And so for those of you that work in big districts, I think there's a gentleman that spoke about that before in the previous session. It is a real challenge. And so I came from a smaller district where trust was easy to gain, and we could do things and be innovative and try those kinds of things. And I was very fortunate, but I'm coming to realize that's not always the case for other people, and there's certainly challenges that they face. So that's been some of my learning of late, a little bit of who I am. I'm definitely not this guy. So I heard this Chuck Norris thing early on, and then I was somehow supposed to replace him. And yesterday, of course, I found out some very interesting things about Chuck Norris in the car ride with Mike Grass. I found out that actually Mike Grass thinks he could take Chuck Norris if he had to, which I believe him. And also I learned about never fight with a monkey or something like that. I always learn so much when I'm in Texas. And so as hard as I could never be Chuck Norris. That's the toughest face that I could possibly muster up. So I know I couldn't take him. Mike says he could, so if we come to blows, I just want to make sure that Mike Grass has my back. But I really do, again, thank you for inviting me to come. Texas is really sort of my go-to place in the States. I've been actually named an honorary Texan. In the past 4 or 5 years, I've had some opportunities to experience some really cool things in all kinds of parts of Texas, from Northeast Texas to El Paso, where Tim's at, and some places in between. So it somehow always centers around food. This was last night's partake of Gordo's Donuts, which is, that's a good thing I don't live anywhere near here, because that would not end well for me. So, but I just want to again thank you for inviting me, and I really do feel pretty comfortable with the folks in Texas, and so again, thank you. One of the things that I really value about this opportunity and other opportunities I have is the ability to continue to connect with someone, with people, and I meet more people. The last time I was here, I really got to know Carl and Brian more than I had before, and so they've become two parts of my learning network and my colleagues, and so I really do ask people to, if they find value in any parts of what I say or feel like there's something that I may be able to contribute to your learning, that you connect with me in all kinds of ways. And I was telling Carolyn, I had a really interesting experience. I spoke in South Florida about a month ago, and I don't know what the conference people did, but I talked about this during a couple of the sessions that I really valued people connecting with me. And since that time, I have gotten an unbelievable number of people from Palm Beach School District have connected with me in all kinds of ways. They've emailed me, they've commented on my blog, they've connected with me on Twitter, they've just done all kinds of things. And I thought, you know what, that's such a powerful message for your teachers in terms of the professional developments that you have aren't just about that day. They're about the continuing learning that happens after that. And the affordances that we have with technology allow us to do that. And so I guess I really encourage you in just that little lesson, that when you are thinking professional development with people, that you don't just say, hey, it's done at 3:30 when you leave the building. Is that if there's something here that resonates with you, there's an idea, there's all kinds of ways that you can follow that up. And so thinking about how to do that, and in this case, I mean, I'm happy to keep contact with you throughout the day. I know this hashtag has been started, so if you're on, and if you don't use, how many of you are fairly active on Twitter? Okay, a small number. If you're not, here's what you do. You don't even have to join Twitter, you don't have to do anything else, but you can kind of participate in what's happening today in other contexts. If you just go to twitter.com and you type in that hashtag and there's a search field there, it will pull up all of the conversations that are happening in this room or beyond using that particular hashtag. And of course that works with anything. So the hashtag, if you're not familiar, is a keyword. In this case, we're using that particular hashtag that will just sort of collate all people's thinking. So you don't have to be a Twitter user, but you can still find value in those conversations. My friend Will Richardson says this: if you're comfortable with education today, you're not paying attention. And after the session that we just had, things that suck, it's evident that you are paying attention, because we're not comfortable with everything that's happening in and around us. So maybe what I'm going to do for you, we're going to take 90 seconds. If you want to do this on your device, or if you want to do this with a pen and a paper, I want you to write down three things that you're not completely comfortable with. Now, when I say that comfortable with, let me just clarify what I mean by not comfortable. It doesn't necessarily mean it has to be something negative. It could be just something I just haven't wrapped my head around. It could be something really potentially awesome, but I'm not comfortable with it yet. Or it could be something that you're really struggling with from a negative side. So I want you to write down three things, okay? I'm gonna give you about a minute to do that. Three things that you would align with that around education. At your table, either the person beside you or whatever, share those things and see if between the two or three of you or whoever having that conversation, you can come up with one thing, either that's common or that you both say, yeah, that'd be the one thing. Okay. So just take about a minute and a half or so, just to have a little conversation around what your ideas are and which one you think maybe is most relevant. Have any problems, because I'm sure some of you have moved right to here's how we're going to fix that thing we're uncomfortable with. But just so that you can even come up with senses about things that are sort of on your mind, I want to hear from maybe about three tables or people that just say, yeah, we kind of actually have the same thing in common. So who's got an idea? I see this young lady with her hand up, but I don't know if she just... You have your hand? I don't know. Maybe you're just very animated. Are you Italian or something? Was there something at your table that you actually said you're... Is this what we're uncomfortable with? Say it.
Systems and the vouchers. Louisiana next door to us is about to sign in a voucher system, and I'm concerned about what something like that would do in Texas to our public education.
Okay, one more.
Technology, so you don't really need to teach them anything because sure. They can use a phone.
So a philosophical kind of approach and attitudes around that.
So you don't have to teach it.
Right, we're good to go. Yeah.
If I may, just a little extension of that is that a lot of teachers expect all those things that we're here for technology, clearly, but they think it's someone else's job to bring that into the classroom.
Sure.
Like, oh, they're going to do that in computer technology classroom.
Sure.
That really bothers
and
me.
And as folks that are trying to move that agenda forward, that makes it difficult when people are abdicating that responsibility somewhere else. Carolyn, you get the last, I get two more and then we'll go on.
It bothers me that we're doing things sometimes that aren't educationally sound, that we know they're not, and we're doing them anyway.
Okay.
We're bothered by teachers who, even young teachers, that we think are going to be progressive, and they're actually saying to us, no, it should be hard, they should have to do it like I did it, they should have to do it with pen and paper, it should be, you know, it should. They should want it more. We're like,
yeah,
what?
If they only click, click, click and get the answer, that's just wrong.
Sure.
Right, but they're doing that in their pocket.
Well, and I can speak to that being, you know, working at the university level, and it goes back to your point about the kids knowing everything about technology. I mean, I just know that's not true, and I know that our teacher training programs really aren't doing all that they can to prepare kids for a new, potential new and more powerful way of teaching and learning. At any rate, lots of great conversations. And part of what I do that exercise for is to, again, elevate the fact that we do have these concerns, and I can let you go right now, and you can have this continued conversation and learn why. And that's really the point of what I want to share with you. And the other thing I think that's so important for us to keep in mind when it comes to having conversations about technology is to understand that I think we're still in the infancy of figuring out what we're doing with all this stuff. And so I think... As a parent of four kids, I learned, particularly by the time that fourth child came around, to have a lot of humility. That I don't know all the answers. I can't, there's not a book for this that says do X, Y, and Z. And sometimes I'm getting the sense that in our angst to figure everything out, to have the solution, we want to have this all lined up. So we say, well, if you do X, Y, and Z, then this result will happen. And I think what we're noticing with technology is it changes the game, and it's not so, there's not a map for this. And so I really think when people are doing things like creating vision statements and all these and long-term goals, I'm not suggesting those aren't important things. I just think they need to be done with a greater sense of humility and saying, you know what, perhaps we don't know all that we want to know about this, and we have to feel really comfortable with that discomfort and challenges, because it's just not that simple. It just really isn't that simple. And again, I want to go back in my own career when I started. This is me in 1988, and my daughter asked, who's that big kid with the suspenders? That kid like in super kindergarten or something like that? Anyway, so that was me and my first class, and it was interesting when I think back to that very first grade class that I taught, and how many of those kids, because I pulled out that old class photo, and I actually could remember every kid that I taught. And if I went probably to the next year or 3 years, I probably couldn't remember all the kids, but that first year, I remembered them all. So I was going down the list, kind of going down memory lane, and I was thinking about particular students. And so that's actually a kid named Marco. He was a French-Canadian kid. I taught, just so for background, I taught, my first year was at a military base off just where I live. I don't know if you're familiar with the Snowbirds. They're our Canadian flight team, and that's the base where they were, and they had a school there, and that was the first year I taught. So these kids were military kids and from all over Canada. This one was French-Canadian. But Marco was reading when he came to grade one already. He was reading at about a third or fourth grade reading level. So the things that I had prepared for first grade, like, they just weren't going to work for him. But I didn't know what to do with that. So this was just this frustration that continued with me. That was Michael. I'm sure Michael is incarcerated. If he isn't, I actually tried to Google this kid, like, because this kid was, wow. In fact, even to this day, like, I don't know that I've ever taught a kid with that many issues. But I mean, he was the kind of kid. I remember this. He went up to another kid right from behind. I saw him do it. Took his scissors and he cut a V out of the back of this kid's sweater. And being a young teacher and not having any strategies at all, don't do this, please. We were doing some art project, that's why they had scissors, and I had some glue on my finger, and I wiped it on his shirt. I know, I don't know why I did that. It was my reaction. To which he said, "Hey," he said, "my mom's not going to be happy with that." I said, "Well, her mom's not going to be very happy with that." That was my discipline strategy. I know, I don't know why I did that. That's what I did, because that's what all I could think of to do to handle, you know, those kind of things. Actually, I told some of the things that I did when I first started teaching, and I don't think I would be around if I did some of those things today. That was Christina. She never smiled, not once, the whole year. Not one time. And so my whole goal was, I just got to make this kid smile or laugh or do something. She was the most sour kid that I ever had, and I just thought, like, what is, you know, and her although I didn't meet her parents, I kind of understood why after that. But you know, that was this kid, like, you're seven. How come you don't smile ever, one time? And then there was Lacey, who the only thing she wanted to do was draw unicorns all day long. That's it. Didn't matter. Let's do some science. That's not a problem. And she's drawing unicorns. You know, Lacey, there's more to life than just drawing unicorns. But that's all she did. She's very good at it. But I remember that's the only thing she focused on. So, you know, here I am, a young teacher, trying to figure out the fact that I've got, you know, 20-some students in my class, all kinds of different needs. I was hearing terms like individualized instruction at the time. I had no idea what that meant. Not a clue. What do you mean, individualized instruction? How do you do that? I couldn't figure it out. So before 2005, my sort of professional development experience sort of looked pretty similar to this. Like, this is sort of the typical teacher network. I mean, I worked at a school where people were pretty good, like most schools are. They wanted help, but they're busy people. They're doing their own job. They don't have time to solve your problems with Lacey and Michael and Marco and all the other kids. They're busy doing their thing. And so, you know, the opportunities that I had to connect were pretty limited. And before 2005, there just weren't very many opportunities to get together. You had staff meetings. That was supposed to be a time where maybe you could do some learning. But staff meetings don't always go, weren't always used in the way that they should be used. And so it was pretty evident to me that, okay, so that's just where we decide, you know, when the hot dog sale is going to be, and, you know, whether the kids should wear their hats in school, or they shouldn't wear their hats in school. That's all staff meetings were to me. And so, you know, this is just this sort of ongoing dialogue in my head about how am I going to get better at what I do. I mean, it was evident to me early on that the people that I knew that could help me were way more valuable than whatever talent or abilities that I have. Because every once in a while, I would have that experience to sit down with another teacher and learn from them and tell them, here's what I'm struggling with, and they may be able to give me help. It didn't happen often, but it happened enough that I knew, boy, I could kind of do that more and have that access more, I would be a much better teacher than I was. And I think for years we've built our schools and we've had this culture of isolation that we never intended to happen. It just sort of happens. And this is another one of these learnings that I'm experiencing, is that I don't care how big your district is, how small your district is, how big your school, small, urban, rural, whatever, isolation is still a big problem, a really big problem in our schools. And it doesn't matter how many people around you, when you're put in a room to work with kids all day long and your expectation is you figure it out, it doesn't take long before people really get that sense of isolation. And I think we're trying to move forward from that. That we hear more talk around that we need to change this culture. It's still really difficult to change. But we're starting to see people think about the idea of collaboration and moving together. But until recently, this was pretty difficult. Today we're in this new era where the medium is changing. And this is a quote by Neil Postman. And this is where I'm really continuing to rethink. Is that a medium doesn't just add something, it changes. In 1500, the printing press was invented. You didn't have old Europe plus the printing press, you had a different Europe. And after television, America was not America plus television. Television gave a new coloration to every political campaign, every home, every school, every church, to every industry, and so on. And then he wrote this back in the 80s, thinking about it really changes things. And the difference was, with the printing press and television, it changed over quite a long period of time. We know that the adoption of televisions, in fact, was quite slow before people had, first they owned a television, then they got a color television, then they got multiple televisions, then they got cable. I mean, all that took place, over probably a period of 50 years before it really sort of was totally ingrained in society. But we're living in an era where that's happened way quicker. And it kind of all, this was the sound that changed it all, right? My sound's not working, but at any rate. So the sound that you were supposed to hear was that sound from that modem that came on. And that sound, that was sort of this anticipation of what's going to happen next. When you plugged in that modem and you fired that up, it's, okay, something cool could just happen. And it really was, in that sense, a disruption. And when I go back to my earlier question about you, and I try to phrase it in the sense that comfortableness doesn't necessarily have to be. If you're uncomfortable, it doesn't necessarily have to be a negative thing. And I would say the same thing with disruption. And technology right now is a disruption. It's changing things. It's saying to us, we can't do things the way we did it before. And I think this is the real challenge that I'm seeing, is that we're trying sometimes to try to use technology to sort of do the same things that we've done, just better, right? We just want to make it better, right? I think it was Steve Jobs or Henry Ford, sorry, that said, I think Jobs quoted him, saying that if you ask people, this is back when there was a man in the automobile, if you ask people what they want, they say, I want a faster horse. They weren't thinking about an automobile that completely changes it. And I think that's kind of where we're struggling with, because we want people that say, well, let's just do what we've been doing, but let's just do it a little bit better. As opposed to saying, wait a minute, we can really actually change things a lot and do things even, in a different way, and it's in a disruptive way. So it's embracing this disruption, I think, that's where we're really at challenging. It's been interesting, when I hear the word reform around education, I really have to have my ears up about what do you mean by reform, because some people, when they mean by reform, it doesn't mean the same thing that I think a lot of you and a lot of I think about when I think about reform and really changing the way school happens, as opposed to we'll just get better at it, make it more efficient what we've already done. But let's look at a few examples around the world and different places in society where we're seeing this disruption, I think, really influence society in some interesting ways. So first of all, business is obviously recognizing the disruption. And that the quote that I have there for you is a conversation that was had back in about the mid-2000s. So the New York Times and newspapers itself went online, roughly around 2000. In the late 90s, they started experimenting with putting the newspapers online. And the first model that they used was a paid model. So if you want, if you subscribe to the New York Times already, you could actually maybe go online, or you could buy a subscription to a newspaper online. Well, there's a kid in Florida, or not only was in Florida, but he was reading Dave Barry, who's a columnist from, I think it's a Miami paper or some sort. He really liked Dave Barry. He's a funny guy. He writes a lot of great stuff. So he subscribed to his paper, was copying his column, and then posting it on his website for people to read. And so the conversation that a couple of folks at the New York Times were having around this, he says, when a 14-year-old kid can blow up your business in his spare time, not because he hates you, but because he loves you, you have a problem. And you know, that idea is, how do we rethink this? Because this isn't somebody that's just trying to be malicious. He really likes what we do. It just doesn't work with what how we're trying to sell things. And so we've seen the newspaper industry, in fact, really go through all kinds of turmoil and try to figure out, well, what do we do now? Like, how do we do our business? And you know, it would be just fascinating to hear the boardroom conversations of some of our biggest newspapers and the kinds of challenges that they've had in trying to rethink their industry. The music industry, of course, went through this with Napster and all kinds of things, and it disrupted the way they did things. They can't do it the way they've always done it. And so that's just been a constant thing in business for sure. Certainly governments were seeing all kinds of things happen with technology. And it's just one little quick clip that'll give you some insight as well. So where's my sound? I have it on my machine.
I think I turned it down quickly, trying to get rid of that.
Oh.
Coney, Google's reach.
Let me go back.
That wall of fear fell in the last few weeks as hundreds of thousands of Egyptians defied their government and demanded change. Helping to lead the charge, 30-year-old Wail Koni, Google's regional marketing manager for the Middle East, who in his spare time created a Facebook page posting information about the brutality of Egyptian police. He was especially angered by the killing of a 28-year-old internet activist beaten to death after trying to expose police corruption. The Facebook page was called We Are All Khalid Saeed. Soon, hundreds, then thousands of others began sharing photos and video of abuse and mistreatment. Within months, the number of followers on Facebook grew to 500,000. And when he and other organizers posted the dates and locations of protests, people started showing up and posting internet videos like this one. Many of the organizers never met in person. Their primary interaction was online.
If there's no social network, does this revolution happen?
If there was no social networks, it would have never been sparked, because the whole thing before the revolution was the most critical thing. Without Facebook, without Twitter, without Google, without YouTube, this would have never happened.
And we're seeing this, you know, around the world all the time, the way that it's democratized. Technology has the power to democratize knowledge and empower people. And that's what we're seeing in these kinds of pretty big, significant ways. And I think, again, trying to understand that from all aspects is it's not that simple. And these are the kinds of conversations that, boy, every high school civics class or beyond that should be having all the time around trying to understand how does this happen? How does this work? Because it is completely disruptive. Certainly from a personal aspect, thanks to YouTube and cheap digital cameras, we're now producing media and content like never before. The key thing here is that idea of broadcast yourself, and that's flipping around an industry, that's flipping around the way we think about publishing. I read the other day that publishing isn't even a thing anymore, because now publishing is a button where you just click it and it's online. That's publishing. Done. So what does that do? And again, I understand there's problems with that too. I'm not necessarily saying that's perfect, that's awesome. There's awesomeness about it, no question. But it's complicated. It's challenging stuff that we're trying to wrap our head around. But, I mean, when you think about the fact that in YouTube now, I think that the statistics I had last was in 2 months, YouTube produces as much content as the three major U.S. networks have done in 60 years combined. That's, if we're not paying attention to that and starting to understand what that means, I think we're doing a disservice. We're doing a real disservice. So let me go back to my story. So after 2005, for me, this was a big turning point. I just decided, I was a technology director. I'd heard about this thing called blogging, and I thought, gee whiz, what is this? I created websites before. I knew Dreamweaver. I think this still is Dreamweaver still a thing?
Yeah.
It is. Okay, there you go. So it's not dead, but I do all kinds of stuff. I can create all kinds of really cool stuff on the web. But then there's the thing of blog. Well, that's dumb because it's so easy. Just press the mouse and then I've got a web page set up. So I did that in 2005. And I started writing on it. Well, this was my very first entry, which was just awesome. Right? I've been looking at blogs for a while, felt it was time to take the plunge, let's see how it goes. What brilliance was that, right? So I started, I didn't know what I was doing, so I just started writing, and I put anything on there, and I really had no concept of how it was going to work or what would happen. And all of a sudden, I got a comment, and I thought, well, that's interesting. So I looked up, and this guy, his name was Casey Hales. And I thought, well, Casey Hales, do I know anybody named, I don't know anybody named Casey Hales. So I did a little rudimentary searching around and found out this guy was from New Braunfels, Texas. And that just really was interesting to me in so many ways. Wait a minute, why did this guy, and he was a special education teacher at the time, I wasn't writing anything about special education, so there wasn't anything particularly that I thought he might find useful, but apparently he thought that I did. And he commented a few other times on my work, and I kind of find it. I found where his stuff was, and I tried to sort of interact with him. But it was a pretty strange kind of thing that just sort of led me onto a journey of, this is interesting, that somebody from Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, has somehow made an impact with some little bit of sharing of an idea or two to someone, you know, 1,500 miles away. That's interesting. So that led me on to some other things. Then I discovered this little button here. This little button is a pretty awesome little button. People don't talk about that button anymore, but for me it's still a pretty powerful thing. What is that button?
RSS.
An RSS feed. Yeah. It's interesting when you talk this about in a different group and nobody knows what it is. But most of you would know what that is. But that allowed me, that was sort of my gateway into finding a whole bunch of really smart people. Some of you are in this room. Miguel, I don't know, when did you start blogging, Miguel?
A long time ago.
I know, it was a long time ago. Give me a date.
Oh, same time Wes Fryer did.
It was, well, we were all kind of about the same time, because I remember sort of finding these guys online about the same time, and all of a sudden, well, this is really cool, because he had a similar job that I did, and he would write about stuff, and I thought, well, he's crazy. And then I read about his blog, he still is. And I'd say, you're crazy, and he might do the same thing for me, and all of a sudden I thought, well, this is kind of interesting that we can have this kind of dialogue back and forth. And it came to me that this has become my sort of formula for life right now. This is it right now. So you find smart people, that's what you do first, then some kind of really cool stuff, and then you get to be the beneficiary of that smart stuff. That's really it. That's all I do. I just find a whole bunch of smart people, and I continue to learn from them, and then something happens along the way that I take those ideas, and I kind of make them my own, but I realize I got them from somewhere else, and I share them out with other people, and I hope they're doing the same kind of thing as I am. So the question that I continually ask people, because I think, well, I know a few smart people in this room, but I don't know all of you, is I ask you, can I find your best work online? Could I learn from you? Could you be my teacher? And obviously when I ask people like that, people go, well, I don't know if you could find my best work. No, you can't find my best work online because... And I just keep asking, well, why can't I? How come I can't find? And I get really disappointed. I get really disappointed when I go to a conference, when I hear a speaker or talk to someone, and I think, that person's really brilliant. They've got some really good ideas. I wonder what else they've done, because we just had this brief interaction, whether I listened to them speak or I had a conversation with them, and I go online, and I don't find anything. I'm disappointed, because I thought, well, that's it. We're done. I'm not going to maybe come back here. We're not going to have a chance to interact. I guess my learning's done. And that disappoints me because on the flip side, I've had the other experience where I thought, I've had this great conversation with somebody, And then I've gone online and find out, well, they got a whole bunch of other stuff I could learn from. This is awesome. I've got this pool of goodness and ideas. And not only is there stuff online, but I can ask them questions about the stuff that they have online. I can interact. I can say, hey, can I use this? Or what else have you got? Or what are you thinking about this? And pretty soon, that just changes the nature of learning. Because now I don't care about the stuff anymore. I care about the person and the way in which we can interact. So I challenge you. I mean, I'm not going to ask people to speak to that. But I want you to think right now about, is your best stuff online? And if it isn't, why isn't it? Why can't I find that? Because I find it frustrating if I can't. And you're saying, well, you don't have the right to do that kind of thing. Well, I don't know if I do or not. I'm saying that's my expectation. I did get into a little trouble, actually. And this was probably 3 years ago. I wrote a blog post. I just gone to hear Al in November in his big conference in Boston. And I heard about four or five great speakers, of which two or three of them had no online presence. And I wrote about it. I said, I'm disappointed. Because I thought these were smart people, and I wanted to keep learning from them. Well, actually, one of them emailed me back and kind of berated me about I had no right to ask them to put their stuff online and whatever else. I mean, that's fine. Maybe I'm out of line. I'm just saying my expectation is that I would be able to do that because I have that experience with so many other people. And I don't care if you're famous, if you've written a book or whatever. You've got some good stuff to share, and you're doing good work. I assume you're doing good work at some point that you should be proud of and you should be able to share, even if it's not the finished product. It's your thinking. It's the things you're going through that I think are as important as the final product. All right. Let's talk a little bit about collective knowledge. Okay, so who do you know? All right, no talking. Six pictures up there. See how many you can recognize without having a conversation, just on your own. Anybody know six? Five. We got a five. Four. How many say? I probably know four. Three. And we won't go any lower than that. All right, at your table, see if you can nail them all. Conversation. How many felt like they learned something in that session? They said, yeah, I hadn't thought about that. That was a good point. How many said, yeah, that was a good point? I mean, most of you would. Even if you, whether you agreed with that and said, yeah, I hadn't thought about it in that way, or perhaps somebody raised an idea that you said, yeah, I hadn't thought of that before. That's important to think about. I think that's such a critical thing for us to do. And I worry when we talk about the nature of school that we're still fostering a mind your own business kind of learning, where kids sit in rows, where their heads are focused on their work, and you hear things like, eyes on your own paper, no talking. Boy, I wonder if is that really the kind of learning that we want to have happen in our classrooms? And then I think, you know, sometimes I worry that our technology isn't even helping it, because I've been in classrooms where I just see kids staring at screens all day long, and I don't know that that's a whole lot better in many cases. I mean, I spend a lot of time in front of the screen. I'm sure a lot of you spend a lot of time in front of the screen, and sometimes in front of that screen, we are interacting with other people, and so it isn't a mind your own business learning. But I just think, too, about the nature of bringing people together in a building, in a place, boy, you better take advantage of that. That's a precious moment. I mean, the fact that you guys are all here, if there was no talking for 2 days that you're here, you would say, well, that was kind of a waste, right? Of course you're going to talk. Of course you want to interact. So when I wrote about this on my blog, thinking even about the dangers of one-to-one. I mean, I think one-to-one computing is really powerful. And I get it, and I advocated for it. But not if it's this. Not if it's just kids sitting in front of a screen all day long. Because I've seen that before. So that's why I've said, you know, I've seen a 3-to-1 program where I'm more excited. Like when I go to school and I see 3 kids huddling around a machine, having a conversation, building stuff together, I think that's what I like to see. That's awesome. That's great learning. So sometimes 1-to-1, and again, I think that just challenges us in thinking about our ideas and the fact that same idea can be taken in completely different directions depending on the conversation. What do you mean by one-to-one? What do you mean by reform? What do you mean by all these kinds of things? We really have to unwrap what we mean them, because they can be very, very different, same kind of concept. But I think it really does go back to this idea of social learning, which I think is just a critical thing. It's just absolutely critical to my mind. But you might want to tell that to this fellow, this Chris Avener, because Chris Avener was a university student in Ryerson in College in Toronto. And what Chris thought, he thought that was a good idea, is learning together. So he started a Facebook group for his chemistry class, and it's just a study group online. Well, the university found out about that and said, you can't do that. You can't have a study group on Facebook for this because of all these other things. And so they actually kicked him out of school, to which he went and sort of fought it, and he did get put back in. But it was one of these prime examples of disruption, because the university couldn't figure out, because he was arguing the fact that it's just a study group. I could have a study group in one of your physical buildings and call people together. I'm just doing this online. And the university said, well, no, it can't be online, and they had all these reasons why. And here's some of the reasons. These are the reasons that they told Chris, and it goes back to the ladies at the back, your earlier statement. This is what they said. There's 3 reasons against them. Learning should be hard. There is no structure of regulation for online behavior, and that makes it incompatible with academic work, and it's our job to protect academic integrity from any threat. In other words, unless learning is hard and directed by others, it fails to meet the standards of academic rigor. That was their position. I mean, at the end of the day, it's we can't control this. So you can't do it. Instead of thinking about, well, wait a minute, maybe there's some possibilities here. And so I think, again, that's a pretty, you could probably think of lots of examples in your own situation where, yeah, I can, you know, and I can see the university side of this trying to figure out, well, gee, this kind of throws what we do out the window. If all of a sudden you can invite anybody else in to teach that you're paying money, you know, there's a lot of problems with it. I get it. But what I really am bothered by is the lack of dialogue around the fact, well, wait a minute, like, let's think about, what's the ultimate goal here? Is this kid learning, and are we facilitating that learning, and is he doing it in other ways? We need to rethink this stuff. But our reaction so often is, gee, let's make a policy right now, you know, and do something quick to, you know, to sort of quiet everybody instead of saying, it's messy, it's complicated, so what are we going to do about it? Let's think about it. A great book that I've been reading, just finished reading, actually, called Too Big to Know by Dave Weinberger, really talking about this whole nature of knowledge itself and the shifting notion of what knowledge is. And just as a sidebar, and again, I won't go into detail, but just one idea that I'm still wrestling with. He talked about the idea of facts, and the fact that the word fact is actually a relatively new term, that people didn't used to think about facts, and yet that's such a big thing. Just a really interesting section on facts. But just a couple of really, I think, important ideas that I pulled from there. One was he talked about books in particular. He said that books are designed to contain all the information required to stop inquiries within the book's topic. But now that our medium can handle far more ideas and information, now that it's connected medium, ideas to ideas, people to ideas, and people to people, our strategy is changing, and that is changing the very shape of knowledge. And that's pretty close metaphor to what schools have been as a container of knowledge. Here is what you need to know. And if you want to go beyond that, we really don't have the time or capability for you to move outside of that little container because it's not one of our objectives. It's not part of the curriculum. We won't have time for you to do that. So we have to confine the way learning looks like. So it was very much boxed in. And he's saying, well, the internet has no shape. It goes wherever it wants to go. And wrapping your head around that. And then further to that idea, and I love this quote. Well, first of all, just to mention that Britannica has totally axed their encyclopedias. No blog, that was of last month. A month ago, they decided we're done. Because books, in itself, have that limitation. Because it can't go further. If there's an idea in that book that's not resolved, that's it. So books, the nature of the media is such that it has to try to wrap up the story. It's like a television show, right? Unless you're going to have a sequel or an episodic program, it's got to be done in 30 minutes or an hour. It's got to wrap up. Can't have the loose ends, because where else would you go with the loose end? We don't like that. Books are of that nature. He says, bringing together smart people is an ancient and effective technique for developing ideas. This right here, what we're doing, right? The net also lets smart people connect and communicate. But the net brings together in a new and occasional weird configurations. And I dropped up. But I love that idea, this weird configurations. The Casey Hales from New Braunfels that connected with me, that's a weird configuration that brings people together. And that weirdness is something I'm very much interested in, because it's just something that you don't normally get. And think of the prime example of that weirdness is Wikipedia. I mean, we don't hear as much controversy about Wikipedia anymore. There's a few people out there that are still kind of anti-Wikipedia. Wikipedia is not perfect, but I love this quote, that the problem with the Wikipedia is that it only works in practice. In theory, it can never work. And that's true, right? The first time you heard this, what do you mean people all around the world are going to create an encyclopedia? That's not going to work. It'll never happen. It happened. And it happens actually to be reasonably accurate. Reasonably accurate. Sure, there are errors, but there were errors in our other encyclopedias, and there were studies that were done that proved that the difference in errors between Encyclopedia Britannica and Wikipedia were virtually the same. The interesting part about Wikipedia, if you've never gone into Wikipedia and looked and clicked the discussion tabs, you're missing out, particularly on a controversial topic. Click the discussion tab and find out, how did they get there? And how did they negotiate this information? What were the back and forths around this? The other thing I love about Wikipedia is at the very top of the page, it'll give you a warning. This article is not done. Or this article is controversial, so read it in such a way. Does your newspaper do that? Do they say, hey, you might want to watch when you're reading this, because we might not have the facts all right. Go ahead. You don't, right? Because the assumption is they got it all right. Wikipedia tells you up front, hey, you might not have it all right. So take it with that context in mind and read it and learn from it. But again, click those discussion tabs, you'll find out. But this great ability to bring people together and learn from one another, again, this is the Dave Weinberger quote that I love. This is the smartest person in the room is the room. It's everybody working together and learning together and collaborating. And again, the room now is different. The room isn't just this room. It's how many of you have already had a conversation in the last half an hour with somebody that's not in this room? You've interacted with somebody that's not in this room. Seriously? Wow. I need to talk to you. That's pretty interesting. All right? So how many of our classrooms would be able to say the same thing with our students, that they've had an interaction with somebody not in the room? And what would we feel about that if they did? Would that cause angst? Would that cause us to say, whoa, we'd be like Ryerson and say, we got to close that down. That can't happen. Or would we say, well, wait a minute, let's see what else we've learned together. The thing that I think, this, I love this next quote as I told you, I work for Discovery now, and about a month ago we brought together, they're launching a textbook right now around science. I think it actually is released here in Texas, aligned with the curriculum. And, I mean, one of the things that I like about working for this company is that they really do want to get it right, and they really are listening to what other people have to say. So we brought in about 20 people who we knew would push back at the idea of what a digital textbook should be, and they weren't there to tell us how awesome it was. They were there to say, give us some feedback, saying, you know what, we haven't got this right. And one of the ideas that came out of that particular day was the statement by, it was Angela Myers, but Audrey Waters tweeted it. I love this. This is such an important one, a big shift. Isn't that the content is digital, it's that the learning culture is participatory. That's the shift. That's the shift. It's not that you have a Kindle that has all your books on it. That's pretty cool. That's pretty neat. But the interesting thing is that when you're reading your Kindle, did you know that if you highlighted things, that it's stored for you and it goes in a social space and other people can read the things that you've highlighted and you can read the things that other people have highlighted, and somehow reading now has become a social idea that you can say, oh, I missed that part. That's the interesting part of it. And until we sort of wrap our head around that shift and really sort of embrace that, if we're just thinking digital, all we gotta do is make our content digital, I think we're really missing out on that key aspect. So, again, that's not an easy idea. I don't know exactly how you move forward with that. I just think you have to keep that idea completely in mind. And I've been learning this a long time now. This is one of my students about three semesters ago, and this was at the end of the student. Here's a fourth-year student ready to go into his teaching profession. And he said this, he said, it's amazing how much you can learn as a collective when you get rid of the notion that all knowledge must come from the instructor. I felt pretty good about Mike going into a high school when he had that idea right in his hand, that it's not about, I can't be the sole person. And even as much as we've probably said that for a long time, the structure of school is such that it's hard to move out of that mindset, because you've got 20 and 30 students in a room. We're expecting all kinds of things from you. You're there to lead, and the way in which you lead that sometimes comes across as you know it all. It's going to end with me. Learning is going to, I'm the gap stop to learning. So in my course, I really did want my students to start thinking about the idea of learning, and I think that's such a big question. So I had them do a project in the fall where they had to pick something, anything that they wanted to learn about. So these are, again, keep in mind, these are teacher candidates. And I wanted them to think from the perspective, not being a teacher, but being a learner. What is it like to be a learner? And really document that process. And also, put it online. What does it mean to learn online? So I decided I needed to do this too. And don't worry, it's muted for a reason this time. I was going to learn to play the guitar. So I said, okay, you guys are, and so they were learning all kinds of different things. Some were learning how to cook. It didn't matter to me what it was. You just got to learn it online and document it. So I decided I was going to learn guitar. And I have a daughter who's, she has a music degree. She's a pretty good musician, but she wasn't interested in teaching her dad. And so she gave me a few things to get started and then said, okay, you're kind of on your own. All right, so that's fine. So I put this on my blog, and it wasn't that much later that I got a call. There was somebody on Twitter said, Brian Snyder said, this guy needs some help learning guitar. Could music ed, and again, talk about hashtags. So if you search through the hashtag for music ed, you'd find out people that are using that that are music education teachers. Help him. Well, he just sort of took the bull by the horns after that and said, tomorrow, my theory students are going to give him a guitar lesson. So they did. And they built, here, it's a, here's your staff. So they built a webpage for me with lessons, individual lessons. They'd listen to me play, they'd laugh, I'm assuming. Then they'd create their own lessons. So this is my teaching staff. These 9 kids from Connecticut teaching an old man from Saskatchewan how to play guitar. Now, if that's not awesome, if that's not awesome, I don't know what is. That was awesome. So here's Austin's lesson for me. Now, I've probably watched that video 12 times, because as I'm learning it, you know, I'm following along, watching. Now, here's the interesting thing, though. How many, you know, there's been a lot of talk lately about Khan Academy, for example, as this great resource that people can use, and people are taking it in all kinds of directions I don't think it was ever intended to be. And there's a lot of videos online right now of people teaching guitar similar to that. But nobody made a video for me. This video is for me and what I need. And so when you think about using something like a Khan Academy, which I think is great, there's math tutorials online that can help a kid, it's not the same as a teacher who says, I'm going to help you with what you need, and I know you, and so the nature of that relationship now is very different than a random person online. Again, I'm all for that. I think it's great that we have those resources, and I did look at some things online as well. But that was different. That was very different and pretty powerful. There's also a little Texas connection with this. So here's my one of my students, Stacy. Stacy wanted to learn sign language. And so I don't know if it was before. Was it before or after I came that we hooked her up? So anyways, I actually was down here and found out that one of the teachers at Westlake here in Austin was a full-time American Sign Language teacher. And I thought, wow. You should help my student. And Barbara, was her name, said, yeah, I'd love to. So they Skyped, and her students taught my student sign language. And there's a bunch of the students that left specific comments, because she created a little video showing kind of what she was working on. Barbara's students wrote back to her. But I love what Stacy wrote on her blog. She said, I admire Barbara because, of course, she has no obligation to help me learn. It's just out of the goodness of her heart. And I admire that. This is the kind of teacher I want to be. She also is allowing your students to be the teacher, which I admire as well. I think that's the best way to learn and master what you teach. Well, that's old news. We've known that for a long time, that the best way to learn is to teach it. But now we have these wonderful opportunities.
I was to ask if they could send some of their videos on a DVD so his ukulele club could watch and learn. But Patrick Costello had a different idea. He created a ukulele lesson plan, posted it to his website, and invited ukulele players from all around the world to make their own instructional videos for the ukulele club in a Goki post. Patrick says the idea was to give the kids a glimpse into how music can bring people around the world together, and at the same time, give folk musicians the opportunity to develop their teaching skills.
Hi, I'm Daniele from Reggio Emilia, Italy, and this is my entry for the ukulele project.
So I guess starting to come in now are all these videos from all over the world, really, just everyone taking turns and teaching one lesson at a time and uploading those videos to archive.org.
Oh, yeah, it's Andy here in the UK, in England.
Hello, this is Tim Davis in Gwangju, South Korea.
I think it was Tim in Korea who put together an introduction to the song Skip to My Lute. So we got to watch him sitting on a beautiful stone wall with some kind of temple or interesting building in the background, as he hung along to skip to my loo and taught us how to play it.
I'll find another one prettier than you.
It's kind of a remarkable thing because these kids who live in a place that's so limited, you know, we're having conversations through the internet with folks from around the world who have an interest in music. It's like building a shared language and making it possible for them to converse on these terms with people from very different backgrounds.
So some things have to change in order for us to see some of those kinds of learnings actualized in our classrooms. I think there's some attitudes that have to change. First of all, I think we have to get rid of the notion, rethink our notion of strangers. We think of strangers as bad. That's a picture that I took in France. It was Easter Sunday, 2009. It was on Notre Dame Cathedral. Pretty cool place to be on Easter Sunday. And this old man here, kind of a very grizzled, tough-looking guy, was standing and feeding birds. And he's holding out the seed, and he's feeding these birds. And all of a sudden, it was like a Pied Piper. These kids came up to him because they just thought, this is so cool, right? They stood beside him, but, you know, he didn't look like the kind of guy you want to approach, but they just stood there kind of waiting. He looked down at the one girl, and he grabbed her by the hand, and put her up on the ledge, and he puts the seed in her hand, and all of a sudden, she's feeding birds. And then it was just, and I'm sitting just over here, and I probably snapped 50 pictures of that scene, watching this take place. But I thought to myself, that's a stranger. You can't do that with strangers. But the thing was, of course, parents are there in the background. They're watching it. They're seeing all this happen. And I never told my kids ever to talk to strangers. It's just that there were certain places where strangers were, it was a good place to learn. You're all strangers to me. I'm not too worried about most of you. But to have these blanket theories or ideas of strangers equals evil is really ridiculous. And so we really need to change the way we think about that kind, how we approach the idea of strangers. And so instead of thinking of the internet as having 2 billion predators out there, what about 2 billion teachers? And I'm not saying either of those are accurate. I'm just saying, why can't we start thinking perhaps differently about what the internet might be and the ways in which we can do these things? And that's not to throw caution to the wind. That's not to say that we don't want to be mindful and careful about it. But it's a very different perception when we think about the potential of this. And here's a great example, one of my favorite videos. It's a little guy from Vancouver Island that wanted to learn how to start fires. So he put this little video online.
I'm trying my hardest here to make a bow drill set. This is my spindle, and this is my block that you put on the top. So when you're spinning it around like that, so it won't melt into your hand. And then this is the bowl that I use, and I just use some paracord, nylon paracord. And then this is the hearth that's made out of yellow cedar. The hole is right there, and I tried another hole, but that was too deep, so it didn't really work. And then this is the tinder, just normal dryer lint. And I'm going to show you how I do it. And I'm doing it wrong. I know I am. And please comment down below.
So his expectation right off the bat is that somebody's going to help me. I can learn from other people. Now, when you have 14,000...
how I actually do it, and I'm going to test it out.
14,000 views, that's not that impressive. But 82 comments is pretty significant for a 14,000 view video. That's a very high ratio. And not only was that a high ratio, but the specific comments that people made to help this kid learn were unbelievable. Here are strangers that have, why are they doing this? Well, first of all, he has a mom who helped him put this online, who showed him how to tag a video properly that would attract people who were interested in bushcraft and fire starter and these other things. So when they go online to YouTube and they type in that search term, his video comes up. They watch it and they say, oh, I can help this kid, and they do. And I'm constantly amazed by people that do that, because we just assume that people are evil and nasty and never will do that. But I do that. That if you were seeing something online around something that you have expertise in and interested in because you're teachers, you would want to help. You'd say, oh, I can help that person, because you do that all the time. That's your job. And the reality of it is there's lots of people who have that same disposition when it comes to helping other people learn. So the other story I just want to share with you is Dan Meyer. And this is the story about economics. So thinking about rethinking strangers is I think, important. But understanding the economics of sharing is pretty powerful. So Dan is a math teacher from California. And he does a lot of really interesting stuff with video and stuff around using visuals in mathematics courses. And I interviewed him about a particular project he did called Graphing Stories.
This was in my third year of teaching, and I was really unhappy with a particular transition between math topics, the transition to graphing from single variables. And I got this idea, and I spent, I recall, about 18 hours on a weekend. So a total of 48 hours, 18 of those were spent either filming this, the raw materials for this lesson, or editing them on my computer, or putting them into a format that I could use in classroom. It was just a long lesson. And I mentioned it on my blog that I had done this, and a lot of people said, look, this is a recipe for burnout to spend that much time on one lesson. Instinctively, I thought to myself, well, look, I can reuse this every year hereafter if it's good. And it was very effective for my goals. And then, to give credit to their concerns, I put it online the day after in a format that could be downloaded by anybody anywhere. I put it a DVD disk image so you could download this image and create a physical DVD that I used in class. It had the generic handouts on it, some instructions for using it. I just put it up there, just like that. I figured that the more people used it, the less cost those 18 hours were to me, so I was really interested in a lot of people getting whatever use out of it they could. So if someone, I offered people, I would mail them the DVD, the first 30 people who posted about it on their blog, so I got some traffic coming my way, and eventually, at the end of 2 weeks, I checked my stats and 6,000 people had downloaded the disk image in those 2 weeks. So in an instant, my 18-hour time cost felt like nothing to me. It was much more worthwhile.
Now just start thinking about the economics of that. If we start doing that as educators, if you start doing that, that kind of sharing around, here's some best practices, here's some things that I've done, and you're giving that away. Again, the hours that your teachers would spend in the evenings preparing and studying, how could that be even more productive in ways that we share? And I think that's just a powerful, that's an attitude around a gift economy, which is, that's the economy we live in right now. It's a gift economy, and that there's so much stuff out there that I learned from other people that is absolutely free. I feel obligated to share whatever little bit I have, and hopefully some other people find it valuable. And I know that obviously not all the stuff that we do is awesome and valuable, but a lot of it is. And so understanding that culture, the fact that I know that Miguel is going to be blogging, that I can always find stuff that he's been doing, that Mike and Scott are doing, that they're sharing that kind of stuff, that's available to me. There's goodness in there that I can decide when I need it and how I want it. And I hope that other people can find that same. But that's a real shift in thinking in terms of, because I do remember when I first started teaching, there, not often, but I would run into a teacher who would be reluctant to share lesson plans with me. It was like, you go do your own work. I spent this much time developing it, so should you. Really? Can we want to help each other out here? Because there's stuff that I've done that I think, not very often did I find that, but occasionally you find people doing that. But again, developing a culture where that's just the norm, where I can find your best work online, there's some economics around that, I think, that we haven't quite wrapped our head around. The other shift is thinking about time and place as being a restrictive nature of learning. School no longer constrained to how far the bus can travel in the morning, then schools might be the last place to notice this, that learning isn't confined to this space and this time that happens between here and here. And so we're seeing things like flipped classrooms, which are really playing with that idea of time and place, saying, well, gee, we can think of this differently. And I love those, it's the fact that people are pushing the boundaries of when school can happen and where school or learning can happen, and acknowledging that it's not just about what happens here, it's what happens in all kinds of contexts. And then taking that sort of the step further, a colleague of mine, Rushton Hurley, said this the other day. He said that if your students are sharing their work with the world, They want it to be good. If they're just sharing it with you, they want it to be good enough. I thought that was a pretty profound thing to say. And that's so true, right? Dear, you have it good enough. But when you change the nature of where learning happens, that it happens in these public spaces, it changes the nature of, wait, I got to rethink this because this isn't just for you. I don't have to do this just for you. There's another goal in mind, and so my work needs to look differently. And I think that's a real big shift in our thinking. Asking this question, really, is what do we mean by learning? Will Richardson, that I share, he's been asking this question a lot. And I would challenge those people, particularly some of, and I heard a few of you doing a little standardized testing debate around, is it, I think it was you, the one that says, does it even measure? What does it even measure, right? Because if we're talking about learning, what is learning, right? That's a hard question to answer, by the way. I can ask educators, what do you mean by learning? And if I asked you that now to stand up and say, what do you mean by learning? Here's what's going to happen, because it happens to me too. You'd stand up and start talking, and then after about a minute, you'd say, I don't know if that really captures it. But you don't really feel like you really have it. That's our business. You know, some of us have been doing this for a long time, and we still haven't grasped what learning is, really. And so that conversation to me is one that we just have to keep having. What do we mean by learning? What are we talking about here? Is it just about memorizing facts? Because if it is, this kid, a high school student said, the need to know the capital of Florida died when my phone learned the answer. That's over. Okay, so it's not that. What is it, right? What are we going to ask? I love this. What are we going to ask on our tests when our students are walking in with Google in their pocket? Are they going to be better questions than we ask today? What are we asking? What kind of questions are we asking? What are we asking of our students to do and build and create? And what are the affordances that technology brings to that equation? And then thinking about the other thing that has to change is our role, because it's not expert anymore. That's if. Our expertise is still valuable. It's not that it's lost, but we have to be more than that. We can't be the stopping point of learning, as Dave Weinberger says. We have to be able to connect our students beyond that. So when our students are in our classrooms and we're starting at whatever the starting point we have, they've got to be able to go further. And I know a lot of you, Chris and Pranak is really, and Scott, are doing the project-based learning stuff, which is just such a powerful thing. If you're not a connector in that environment, you're lost. Because that's what you're doing. You're giving people starting places, but you need to be able to help them go in different directions that they want to pursue. The course that I do teach is, this is the name of the course. It's called, something Educational Computing. That's the course that I teach. But I'm lobbying to get it changed to this, Smart Folks I Know. Because that's how I've ran that course for years now, is that I bring in, we're going to talk about digital storytelling, I'm going to bring in Alan Levine. If we're going to talk about writing, I know Bud Hunt. If we're going to talk about using mobile technology, I'm going to have Liz Cole come in and share with you. I'm connecting my students to these people all the time, and hopefully that's such a big message of this, of what I'm wanting to teach them, is you need to be able to have these connections. If you remember the graph I showed you at the beginning, your talent is important, but your connections and who you know and how you can find that information and connect with people that you can learn from is so much more important. This is an interesting quote that I've been thinking about. I haven't wrapped my head around it, but I think it's really interesting. Dave Cormier, fellow Canadian, said, the community is not the path to understanding or accessing the curriculum. Rather, the community is the curriculum. Take that at a staff meeting and have a discussion around that. I don't know exactly how I feel about that yet, but I think it's an interesting conversation to have. I really think it's an interesting conversation to have. I've said this for a while. If you think of the internet as just a place to look up stuff, you're really missing the best part, which goes back to the idea it's not just about the digital, it's about the participatory and the way we connect ideas to one another and the people behind those ideas. The guitar lesson from Austin was meant for me. It's not a generic piece of, although other people can find value in that, but it was the connection between somebody that I was specifically learning from. And I think one of our biggest fears is the fact that, if I participate, the stuff I have isn't that great. It's okay, but I just don't feel great about that. And I think far too long, educators are just a little bit too humble for their own good in many cases. And I love what this video has to say.
Any creator of anything knows this feeling. You experience someone else's innovative work. It's beautiful, brilliant, breathtaking. You're stunned. Their ideas are unexpected and surprising, but perfect. You think, I never would have thought about that. How did they even come up with that? It's genius. Afterwards, you think, my ideas are so obvious. I'll never be as inventive as that. I get this feeling often. Amazing books, music, movies, or even amazing conversations. I'm in awe at how the creator thinks like that. I'm humbled. But I continue to do my work. I tell my little tales. I share my point of view. Nothing spectacular, just my ordinary thoughts. So one day someone emailed me and said, I never would have thought about that. How did you even come up with that? It's genius. Of course, I disagreed and I explained why it was nothing special. But afterwards, I realized something surprisingly profound. Everybody's ideas seem obvious to them. I'll bet even John Coltrane or Richard Feynman felt that everything they were playing or saying was pretty obvious. So maybe what's obvious to me is amazing to someone else. Hit songwriters in interviews often admit that their most successful hit song was one they just thought was stupid and not even worth recording. We're clearly a bad judge of our own creations. We should just put it out and let the world decide. Are you holding back something that seems too obvious to share?
So I think the internet really has brought us a couple things. One is access to limited forms of information. The second is the ability to connect with people and where they live. And I'm just going to tell you one last story and I'm done here. Teacher that I taught with for a long time, her name is Kathy Cassidy. She teaches grade one. Her students have been blogging since about 2006. And she does all kinds of really cool stuff with kids. They Skype with other classrooms. They create wikis together. So they're sitting down, this is the beginning of the school year, and they're going to Skype with New Zealand. Now this is kind of a big deal in the sense that I don't remember if they were there after school hours or the kids, because the time zone was such that it wasn't going to line up. Somebody was going to have to be there off hours, which was the case. So anyways, they're getting ready to do this, and they're just ready to call, and Carson, little guy in front, he says, why would we do that? Well, why are we going to Skype with New Zealand? This is crazy. And so she thought about it. You know, she thought, you know what? Here's September. He doesn't realize that from now until the end of the year, we're going to do all kinds of stuff with people. We're going to comment with people that we don't know. You're going to at some point be amused by the fact that an adult will leave a comment on your blog with a spelling mistake, and you'll get really excited when you spot that spelling mistake as a first grader. You're going to create content with other people. You're going to build stories together. You're going to make movies together. You're going to do all this stuff together. So at the end of the year, when after all the stuff, and you ask Carson, why would we do that? That he would answer, because we can learn from them. And I think that is, you know, to be able to understand that that is the power of the participatory nature of learning. And that's the idea of the collective. And again, I think we're challenged and even scared. We're in this infancy, as I said before, of trying to figure this out. And the more opportunities that we have to connect with one another and learn from each other, the better that we're off. First, I think, to think about this, I think there's, first of all, way too much information. This is what we've known this for years, right? But second, we're privy now to more opportunities than we ever had before. But the third is that the power lies in our abilities to connect our kids in safe and ethical and powerful ways, and connect each other and model that kind of learning for one another. So I challenge you to say, this is hard work. I don't know all the answers, but I don't say that this is all of our answers, but I think if we start to understand this and we start to think about changing this kind of a culture of learning for our students and each other, I think we move in the right direction for what's best for our kids. So thank you very much for your time.